Hello, I'm Judy Woodward, the History Coordinator of the Ramsey County Library, and I am delighted to welcome all of our audience here in the building and also our television audience to this third talk in a series being brought to us by Duchess Harris, Professor of American Studies and head of her department at Macalester College. We are so delighted to have Professor Harris with us. This is her, I believe, third annual visit, and I hope the first of many to come. So this program is brought to us by two important sponsors, the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute of the University of Minnesota, who certainly helps us with audience development. For anyone, I don't know if there's an OLLI representative in the room, but I recommend this fine organization to those of you who are looking for many good lectures, not just at the library. They have many venues for talks like this. Also, we are indebted to Minnesota's Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund, which brings us these programs, offers financial support for these programs. The Minnesota's fund came into being through the passage of the Legacy Amendment by the voters of Minnesota, and so we are indebted to all of you who made this possible. And now let me turn the podium over to Professor Harris. Thank you.
There. Thank you so much. I'm really glad to be here this afternoon for my third session with you all. And today's lecture is going to be based on two book series that I've developed through Abdo Publishing. And so the first one is on news literacy, and the other one is on American values and freedom, which is a total of 12 different books, but I'm just drawing on material from some of them. I also need to once again thank Dorothy Toth, who is the creative design person at Abdo, who helped me with these slides. And this is the first time I'm giving this presentation. And so for full disclosure, we were working on this up until yesterday. So, and she gets credit for how they look. Any mistakes with content goes to me. So with that, this first series here, American Values and Freedom, are a collection of books that are part of my new Duchess Harris collection, which came about in December, where I focus on freedom of religion, the right to bear arms, the right to protest, the right to vote, governmental checks and balances. Today, however, in this talk, I'm going to focus on freedom of the press. That's the one book that I'll be using for today's presentation. The other collection of books is about news literacy, where I have one book about advertising overload, how journalists work, your personalized internet. However, I'm going to draw upon uncovering bias in the news, why news matters, and then I think we're gonna have some fun with the fake news phenomena. Okay, all right. So Freedom of the Press is a book that I developed with Carl Cornell, where we really do a background history of, you know, how do we get to the First Amendment historically, and then how does this play out in contemporary time? And so I'd like to just start off with this clip that I have with how freedom of the press is really a part of pop culture, particularly in 2018. So how many of you all have seen or heard of the new movie, The Post, with Meryl Streep? And oh, look at that. You retired people have time to go to movies. Excellent. That's really good. So as you know, this movie is about the Pentagon Papers. And so I thought I would just open up with a trailer from it.
So, can I ask you a hypothetical question?
Oh dear, I don't like hypothetical questions.
Well, I don't think you're gonna like a real one either.
Do you have the papers?
Not yet.
This is a devastating security breach. that was leaked out of the Pentagon? The most highly classified documents of the war.
The Times has 7,000 pages detailing how the White House has been lying about the Vietnam War for 30 years. The way they lied, those days had to be over.
Okay, people are concerned about having a woman in charge of the paper. Then she doesn't have the resolve to make the tough choices.
Thank you, Arthur, for your frankness.
Let's do our jobs. Find those pages.
We're talking about exposing years of government secrets.
Is that legal?
What is it you think we do here for a living, kid?
Ben, I might have something.
It must be precious cargo.
It's just government secrets.
The New York Times was barred publishing any more classified documents dealing with the Vietnam War.
If you publish, we'll be at the Supreme Court next week.
Meaning?
Well, we could all go to prison.
To make this decision, to risk her fortune and the company that's been her entire life, well, I think that's brave.
If the government wins, the Washington Post will cease to exist.
If we don't hold them accountable, who will?
We can't hold them accountable if we don't have a newspaper.
Nixon will muster the full power of the presidency, and if there's a way to destroy you, God, he'll find it.
I'm asking your advice, Bob, not your permission.
She can't do this. The legacy of the company is at stake.
What will happen if we don't publish? We will lose. The country will lose.
What are you going to do, Mrs. Grant?
Okay, so one of the issues that I open up with in my Freedom of the Press book is Watergate. Now, when you have an Ollie audience, Watergate is a conversation. It isn't a teaching moment, right? So it doesn't have to be explained to you that there's a secret source within the FBI, and then you have journalists Bernstein and Woodward who unraveling that there was a burglary in the Democratic National Committee offices in 1972, and that this investigation leads to Nixon resigning. You all probably remember this. So here's something that's pretty sobering. A third of Macalester faculty cannot even remember this. In fact, I'm senior faculty. It happened when I was 3. And so if I'm dealing with undergrads, I have to do this. So if we can do the lights again, this is a fun teaching tool to walk young people through Watergate. Is it possible that we can get the lights down again, Judy? Okay, thank you so much.
It's 1972 and living in America isn't as great as it used to be. The war in Vietnam is still going on, the spread of communism is as threatening as ever, and inflation is making prices go up for basically the first time since World War II. Oh well, at least you have a pretty good president. Richard Nixon seems determined to get things done even in the present situation. He created a plan for withdrawing troops from Vietnam, he relaxed tensions with China and the Soviet Union, and he created the Environmental Protection Agency. It's no wonder he wins his re-election campaign in a landslide against Democratic candidate George McGovern. No one seems concerned with the news of a break-in at Democratic headquarters in the Watergate office complex. Two men were concerned, however, Washington Post reporters Carl Bernstein and Bob Woodward. They published a series of articles which eventually implicate Richard Nixon and his team as being involved in the burglary. The story is made into a book and then later into a movie called All the President's Men. The Senate launches some hearings led by Senator Sam Ervin. They accuse the president of planning and covering up the break-in. During the hearings, it's revealed that Nixon had tape-recorded nearly every conversation while in his office. The Senate committee asks to listen to the tapes, and Nixon declines, citing executive privilege. The drifting goes on for a while until the Supreme Court steps in and says that since Nixon may have committed a crime, executive privilege doesn't apply. So Nixon has to turn the tapes over, and it becomes pretty clear that he was involved in the burglary and generally a bad person, so he resigns. Since the Gerald Ford became president, despite the fact that he was never elected but appointed after Nixon's original vice president resigned, Ford promptly pardons Nixon for whatever he may have done, then loses the war in Vietnam, then loses the election to Jimmy Carter. And that's why today every political scandal ends in gate.
Okay, so if you're helping to pay for your grandkids' tuition for college, this is what they're getting. So I'm not sure if that's a good thing or not, but they enjoy learning like this. So I'm doing the best that I can. And so if we go back and a book like this, of course, I've told you that all the books that I've talked about in this series are teaching tools. It's explaining, you know, how we get to First Amendment rights and, you know, what is freedom of the press. And so we go all the way back to early America when Alexander Hamilton, which, you know, I have all kinds of fun ways to teach about him as well, I'm sure you can imagine, you know, represents John Peter Zenger. And John Peter Zenger is a journalist with the New York Weekly who is writing columns against the governor of New York at the time, who's Governor Cosby. And so what the governor wants to do is accuse Zenger of libel. And what happens is that Zenger is found not guilty, and this verdict leads to the foundation of how we get First Amendment in the Constitution. And so issues like, you know, what is libel and all of that, these are the kinds of things that we'll end up discussing today. And so, you know, a brief, you know, background on the First Amendment really has to do with what are journalists' relationship, how are they going to be connected in talking about the government. And so we're the kind of nation that brags about the fact that you can criticize the government, but you haven't always been able to criticize the government. And so when James Madison was president, he saw the press as a government watchdog, but everyone didn't necessarily agree with that. And so it's actually Thomas Jefferson who ends up pardoning journalists who are accused of sedition. And we'll talk about what sedition is as well. But this is like a very important move in our nation in terms of who gets to say what and how. And that, of course, is even going on now, maybe more so than it ever has. So one of the things that I talk about in this book is how the issue of how things are reported really gets heightened during times of war. So if we return to the Civil War, when the Union government shuts down more than 300 newspapers in the North, right? And so there are all these ideas about how people are going to discuss who the good guys are, who the bad guys are. And this is a moment where temporarily the Chicago Times is shut down, but it's reopened because there's such a public outcry. Similar things happened during World War I, where Woodrow Wilson is president and he launches the Committee on Public Information. And so this also opens up conversations around what is news, what is propaganda. And then this finally leads up to the Sedition Act, where, you know, at first you were going to criminalize people who spoke against the nation during war efforts, but the Supreme Court finally, you know, overrules this so that you can have what we have now, which is freedom of speech. And so if we move more toward what I might consider a contemporary moment, but undergraduates would consider this, you know, far past in the news, you get the idea of having television in people's households. So in the early 1950s, only 9% of Americans own televisions. It's a newfangled thing, right? But it is a way in which people can find out what is happening in the world. And so what happens, of course, is that if you remember from the brief clip from the Pentagon Papers, there's all this controversy about how Vietnam is being depicted. And there are people that are very concerned that they think that the news coverage is unpatriotic and the military ends up blaming the press for losing Vietnam. And so all of this is going on. And, you know, this is important background to have because then it does lead to a conversation around what will federal legislation be around libel. And so, you know, we're going to have the controversy around can you criticize, you know, do you have bias or are you allowed to report? And so what the Supreme Court case is the New York Times versus Sullivan. And this is in 1964, and the Supreme Court actually rules in favor of the New York Times, saying that they have merely made mistakes and they're not intentional in causing malice. And that's basically what the accusation is. And so a lot of this really has to do with how we understand ourselves as a country and who is allowed to speak and in what venue. So freedom of the press now has become very complicated because of technology. And so I would not have even been able to give this lecture, say, 15 years ago, because the internet has changed so much. And so the internet is a space now where the notion of what is malice, what is libel, what is free speech, all of these things come together in cyberspace, and it ends up becoming very complicated. And so now that we have had President Trump for a year, he's proposing rollbacks on what President Obama had for regulations. And so without regulations, internet providers can block access to certain websites and slow down the loading in what you see. And so a lot of this is similar to the WikiLeaks controversy that we've had. And so you have to ask yourself, what is the balance between national security and an American's right to know? And so this is where we are now. So where are we heading with freedom of the press? Conversations now are going on. There's efforts to pass the Freedom of Flow of Information Act, also known as the SHIELD Law. And it's an attempt to make sure that journalists are able to allow to have the freedom that they need to report the stories that they are reporting. And so the Trump administration, however, really is organizing around limiting First Amendment rights. And so this is a moment where we don't know where we are heading in our nation and if we will have what some people might argue is centuries of setbacks. So, you know, I have been in the classroom now for 23 years. We're starting to ask some questions that I didn't even think I'd ask. And so I didn't think that I'd even have to address why news matters. But what I have seen in the last two decades is how young people process and take in information so differently than people of my generation did. And so I grew up with television in the home, and it wasn't a flat screen, it was a TV. And, you know, news being in the kitchen around the time of dinner, you know, wasn't, you know, considered, you know, like an odd thing. It might not have been the best way to have family conversation, but it was something that many Americans did. Whereas now, young people take in most things on their device, separately, unto themselves. And if you allow them, they will come to the dinner table all with their own devices watching different things. And so the idea that news actually has an impact on how we understand the world is critical for these students who often have a difficult time teasing out, you know, what is real and what isn't real, and also don't have a context for when everybody didn't have access to information all the time. Right. And so I historicize somewhat in the book and talk about, you know, Upton Sinclair's novel, The Jungle, which I'm sure many of you all are familiar with. I'm not even sure if that's taught in high school anymore, to be honest with you. And so to explain to them that what Sinclair does in this book is that he has this, you know, fictionalized place called Packing Town, which is really, you know, any kind of place in America. He's really thinking Chicago, where meatpacking is happening. And the function of the book is, you know, to kind of unveil some of the unorthodox practices in meatpacking. What I want students to learn from this, however, is that by getting this information out there, you end up having the federal government taking action, and Congress ends up passing two laws. Now, this is 1906. It's hard sometimes to get young people to think that that particular moment matters, but it really does, because it sets us up for news being able to have investigative reporting that can lead to shedding light on something like, I don't know, Watergate. Right? And so that's the significance of this. So then we really need to talk about what is news. And so I have this divided into three different categories. There are, you know, are other categories, but just for, you know, today, to think about the difference between general news
investigative journalism, and opinion. And so general news reports that the events that are going on, covering international, national levels. That's how things used to be in yesteryear in the 1970s when you had three television channels, right? And so you're choosing between Harry Reasoner, Morley Safer, Walter Cronkite, whomever. That's what general news was. Investigative journalism is similar to what Upton Sinclair is doing with the Jungle, which is uncovering information that might not have been, you know, public, and then exposing it, and, you know, usually around something that's possibly unethical or harmful in present time, you know, scandalous, to bring something to light. And then opinion, of course, is not based on fact. And that is an interesting concept to try to translate for people that spend a lot of time on the internet teasing out the difference between what is fact and what is opinion. So I do a little bit with, you know, folks who were, you know, the pioneers for this. Someone like Nellie Bly, who published a book on the plight of people with mental illnesses in asylums. And this was as far back as 1887. And so what this did was lead officials in New York to do further investigation. And so that was, you know, particularly trailblazing. And then you also have Ida Tarbell, who began investigating Rockefeller's business practices in 1900. And this led to a Supreme Court ruling against Standard Oil in 1911. And so I use these kinds of examples to let young people understand the importance of the impact of when you actually have facts, which is another thing I didn't think I would have to tease about 23 years ago when I started teaching. It's like, what are facts and what are not facts? When you have facts, the impact of unveiling them can have on society. And so what students can relate to is how we search for the truth today. And so then we're able, you know, to talk about former NSA employee Edward Snowden and how he was outspoken in the controversies around that. So that's something that they can relate to. So Uncovering Bias in the News is another book that I did that really talks about that all media is biased, which is something that I don't know is covered very much in high schools. I think sometimes people might talk about how, you know, certain reporting is done differently, but I think this graphic that we have here is significant because this is taken from 2008 when Romney is running against Obama, and it's depictions on how CNN, Fox, and MSNBC covered each character and shows that, or I should say candidate, it shows that each station covered them differently. And so regardless of what your political beliefs are, it's important to understand that whatever you're tuning into is going to have a certain bias. Some were in favor of Romney, some were in favor of Obama. And so, you know, news media has different, you know, ebbs and flows in terms of the significance that the nation organizes around news media. And so the 50s is huge because that is when television comes about. And so a story that I like to share with my students has to do with John F. Kennedy, for instance, whom, as you all know, was from Massachusetts. As a Northerner, he wasn't really familiar with what was going on with the Civil Rights Movement. And so it wasn't until he saw the water hoses on children in Birmingham that he looked at Bobby and said, what is that? Like, what is going on? And so the television was a great mode to bring to attention to people who might be in places like Wyoming, Montana, Idaho, places that civil rights movement wasn't occurring, to see these events unfold and to start asking questions about what they meant. And so you have a big surge during this time period. It comes back around in the 90s when newspapers end up having like another boost and boom. And then of course, when the internet becomes popular after that, you get another boom with people getting their information in that venue. Now, something that's happened in our lifetime, I think about the fact that my kids have no notion that media can stop. Right? So I grew up on the East Coast, and I remember it would be 10 o'clock here in the Midwest, but like at 11, everything would go off, and then it would be like, beep, and it would get gray, right? Do you remember that? It would like, stop, and then there's no more television, which, I mean, I think my kids would, you know, they'd break into a rash, like if they couldn't, like in the middle of the night, like pull out some kind of device and see what's going on. We have a timer on our kids' device now that like shuts it off on school nights at a certain time. And the funny thing is my husband did it and didn't tell them. And so at 10 o'clock, all of a sudden I hear like a shriek from the middle child. And I looked at him and I said, it worked, right? So, you know, because now we have this thing called the 24-hour news cycle. Right? The 24-hour news cycle. Who would have thought of such a thing? And so now it's everywhere all the time. I put these images up here of CNN and Fox just to underscore that these are places that are also doing it differently. And as Americans, in our regular daily habits, we often choose a kind of media and we tend to go to that one. But the truth of the matter is now, if you're awake in the middle of the night, you can go to either. They are there. So here is something that I think is so important for us to have a conversation about, which is that there are essentially six corporations that own the media. And that is definitely something that I am not sure young people really understand until they get in a college setting and there's some pushback into what they know and how they know it. And just to say, you know, well, you know, who owns ESPN? Like, what's that all about? You know, who's doing this? Like, what is Time Warner? Is there a difference between Comcast and Viacom? Right? All of that helps us think about the kind of information we're getting, and what is the vested interest in the shareholders of these corporations for us having certain knowledge? And it takes us back to the Romney Obama, right? So if you support one candidate, what is your vested interest that the other candidate be depicted in a particular way? Which, you know, for people in a room like this, that might not be very sophisticated. I think for a lot of people, this is new information. Okay, so then there's just the whole thing of like information overload. I'm someone that can multitask, but I know a lot of people who just get on the internet and they say, I need to shut down because I'm overwhelmed. It's coming at me every which way possible, which is also a pretty new phenomenon that because we have so much more technology, such easy access to it, that, you know, we're getting messages everywhere, and sometimes because it's so much, it's hard to decipher really what is accurate and what isn't. And I'll talk more about, there's a difference between, you know, accuracy and, you know, just your point of view, right? You can have different point of views, but then there are facts. So searching for the truth. So these are the suggestions that I would give my students, which goes back to the whole thing about, you know, who owns the Disney Channel, right? First of all, ask yourself, who is the audience? And so if you are watching something or listening something, I mean, this also goes to radio, right? Like, I know people that think that certain, you know, radio programs are like biased to a particular way. And so who do they think is going to listen? Check the source, check the site's other articles, figure out what the site is doing and who put it up. Ask yourself if there's any information that's missing, right, after you've read it. That's helpful. Then once again, identifying the author. I tell students all the time, like when we're reading novels, if you come to my class and if we are reading The Fire next time and you have no idea who James Baldwin is, that's not how I'm expecting you to show up here. It really isn't. And then they're like, oh, thanks for that. It hasn't even occurred to them. I'm like, you don't even know who wrote the book. You're just going to read it? No, that's not how it works. You have to pay attention to the sources within the story, right? Now, if this is academic writing, I'd say, why don't you read the footnotes? oh, okay, right? But I mean, you know, just some tips, just some tips to get you through the day. And then, you know, checking out, you know, the different resources. And so, you know, if all of the citations are coming from, you know, a certain point of view, that might give you an idea of who the author is if you look up the author and can't find out who they are. So here we are. If you had asked me 10 years ago if I was going to write a book called The Fake News Phenomena, I would have to say, I don't understand what that means. Because, I mean, I really would not have understood what that meant. But here it is, a new book. And, you know, one of the things that we decided to do when we were conceptualizing this book is, as always, provide a little context, right? Students nowadays haven't really thought a lot about yellow journalism, what that means, and how, once again, if we frame this within capitalism, newspapers competing with each other, something that happened in the late 1800s was that newspapers in New York started trying to increase their sales by embellishing stories. Once again, I try to say everything can have an outcome. So the particular outcome for this is that stories about the sinking of the USS Maine led to publishers writing all kinds of false accounts about this. And what you get is that we're at war with Spain and might not have possibly needed to be there. Now, that can kind of resonate with students now because they're like, yeah, I think we're getting involved in some things that we shouldn't be involved in. I'm like, exactly, exactly. And it's because people believe things that might not be based in fact. And so here's one that I enjoy. This is former presidential candidate Hillary Clinton with none other than Jay-Z and Beyonce. And so they are on the campaign trail, and one of the stories that came out about this is that Jay-Z and Beyonce ended up making $62 million by campaigning for Hillary Clinton. And that circulated widely around the internet, and a great portion of the nation believed that. It's actually not true. I think they wanted to support her. And they did. They didn't benefit financially from that. Now, if you just like process this, because we talked about politics last week, when you support candidates, you don't make money, right? You're supporting them. Usually they ask you for money, right? Like that's just been me. Is it just me? Or are they asking you guys for money too? Okay, that makes me feel better. But it's you don't make money. Somehow people saw this story and said, yes, exactly. They're benefiting. And part of it, of course, also is like, it's those hippity-hop people, right, that are benefiting from that woman in politics who shouldn't be there. And so that's how this goes about. So now we get into the notion of the difference between bias and an actual lie, right? And so I have to emphasize that, you know, we're all biased. Some people don't want to admit that about themselves. I can admit that. I'm biased. I'm biased about all kinds of things. And so, you know, because we are biased, sometimes we don't even ask ourselves if the news is fake or not. And so this image that we have in the book here indicates that, these are stories that are on Facebook, which is like another way that people are getting a lot of their information, that people are following the fake news stories more than the legitimate news stories. So right up here, what we have is, you know, I don't know how many of you all get on Facebook and people make the comments and they track the comments and all that good stuff. So comments on the top 20 Facebook stories that were fake, 8.7 million comments, fake news. So people are just in there. They're like Jay-Z and Beyonce, those hippity-hop people. What are they doing? Making money off of Hillary, right? That's what's going on there. Now that you have the actual legitimate news stories, commentary, 7.3 million. So you have here more than a million people weighing in on the fake news than the legitimate news. Which really, this does make for a new book, right? Because I mean, you know, really, I mean, Facebook isn't more than 10 years old. And so it's like, I don't know, maybe like 11 years old, something like that. But I mean, so we didn't get our news like this in the past, and now we get it like this. And if we're getting it from our friends, or if we're going to, you know, sites that we go to, not thinking that we're biased, then you might actually believe these things. I've read stuff before, and I'm like, it seems like it makes sense. And then I have to stop and pause and say, is that really true? But that's the extent to which this happens. So now, the term fake news refers to fictional stories until just about 2 years ago, right? And then the president came up with what he said fake news is. And so here's a tweet, and this is his official Twitter, because, you know, I made sure that I wasn't promoting fake news. And he says, it's the same fake news media that said there's no path to victory for Trump that is now pushing the phony Russian story, a total scam. Okay? He's giving a new definition. And he's calling news outlets that are reporting against him fake news. Now, for students that I'm taking all the way back to the libel cases, right, like early on, not 1964, but the 19th century cases, I say to them, this is what was happening when Madison was saying maybe there should be freedom of thought. This is no different than Thomas Jefferson. What this is like, what do you do when a candidate is criticized and people want to shut the newspapers down, or, you know, end people's Twitter accounts, whatever the modern mode is, so that there isn't discourse, right? There does not have to be agreement, but if we can push toward, you know, dialogue based in facts, we'd be in a much better place than we are now. So how do we spot fake news? How do we think critically? And so fact-checking is important. One of the things that I tell students all the time is, you know, what is the website address? You know, go to factcheck.org. Also, sometimes you can't say look for poor writing. Unfortunately, sometimes people don't know what poor writing is. So, you know, that's a toss-up. And I mean, that's real. But here are some suggestions about domains, right? So my email address is @macalester.edu. That's my email address. So .edu, connected to a school or a university. .gov, connected to a government website. Websites that are .com or .net can be created by anyone. So my personal website is a .com. My work website is a .edu. So if you're reading a news story from a .com, you have to ask yourself, is this a reporter that's employed by a certain space, or is this commentary? And the person saying it's news. Okay, and so, you know, then there's our own personal responsibility, which is what can we do about stopping the spread of fake news? And so this is something that I think Zuckerberg was accused of, the founder of Facebook, right? Which is, you know, what role did you play in this? How much was this allowed? To be honest with you, I really don't have an opinion on that, because I'm not sure how much that can be controlled or regulated. Like, I don't know if Mark Zuckerberg can, like, come in and, like, you know, do something about what I share and what I don't share. Right? I think part of this has to do with the personal responsibility of, are you sharing things that are accurate? You know, and if you're sharing things, you can just say, this is my opinion, or this is someone else's opinion, but trying to pass it off as, you know, this is highly researched and is factual, that's a different thing. And so I think that one of the things that I hadn't given much thought in this last presidential election was the role of Facebook in the election. I know that 3 years coming up in the election, I will be watching to see how do people learn about candidates. So I think that is, you know, significant, as we understand that people take in this information differently. Like, I think to myself, my kids don't sit down and watch, who I watch. I think I watched, I don't know, not just Morley Safer, Dan Rather, right? So, I mean, there's no sense of doing that. And so if you're not taking in, and it's not that those news spaces can't be flawed as well, right? But because they aren't learning about the world that way, to really be critical about how are you learning about the world. So with that, I've spoken for 40 minutes. I want us to have the opportunity to have a conversation. I think that we'll be able to have some fun and really dig into what freedom of speech really means. So thank you.
And I will... And I will carry the microphone around. Let me turn the lights up a little. Who has the first question? Question? Okay.
So do you have to add a new section now of other governments planting fake news?
You know, maybe that's another whole book, right? I mean, what's so interesting about this writing process is that from conceptualization to print, it's more than a year. And so, as I was saying last week with the Sexism in Politics book, you know, we were at layout by the time, you know, Me Too showed up. And so some of these things, now that they're happening, I might do this differently and ask some of those questions. I can admit we're not asking many of those questions in these books.
Ever the optimist, on your slide that you had where the Facebook fake news got the 8.7 million comments,
yeah.
Is it just possible that 4 million were people saying this is BS?
Oh, definitely.
I'm just wondering. Yeah.
I mean, definitely, right? And part of this is that we don't have studies yet about who is using Facebook. Like, it's really funny. I have been told now that Facebook is for middle-aged people. I'm not offended, right? And so I don't know what the demographics are for who's reading and who's deciphering. I also don't know if it's partisan, right? So, I mean, I don't even want to throw out there that this set of folks did it and this other set didn't do it. And I have been guilty. I've read things before that I thought were true. And then I've gone back and said, wait a minute. And I know that part of my wait a minute comes from, you know, this kind of training. Everybody isn't going to say, wait a minute. But I mean, I've been caught out there. I put something out there once. I got this nice little inbox. My friend's like, that's not right. And I was like, ooh, okay. And so I was like, delete. And then, you know, something that I had this major faux pas with, I had to put a little note up there like, if you saw that on my page earlier, it's wrong. So it happens to the best of us, right?
Right.
Who else has a question? Yes?
The kids that are down in Florida, I think, mm-hmm. are really doing an excellent, to me, mm-hmm. they're doing an excellent job with publicizing what's happening. With the way the media is today, will they be able to sustain it? How can they continue it? I mean, I hope they can.
You know, that's a great question. I mean, part of it, again, goes to audience. Right? Like, how interested are we in listening? Because one of the things with, you know, most young people having this handheld devices is that you can really do it all the time, right? And you don't have to be that old. Like, what my 11-year-old can do on the internet is terrifying to me, right? And so I think that they need a captive audience. The question is, how much have Americans become immune to school shootings, right? Like, how much have we just become like, oh, it happened again, that maybe people, I think it's up to us to maintain the interest.
This gentleman has a question.
Going back to the six corporations that own the media today, mm-hmm. how many of those are leaning left? How many are leaning right? How many are operating on a principle of profitability? In other words, we're going to go where the greatest audience is going to be found. And will any of these six corporations change their modality because of the profit motive?
You know, I think that's an excellent question. I just want to bring the slide back up. You know, I am not sure that I have the expertise to answer that. I think that anyone in this business is for profit. I mean, that makes all the sense in the world to me. And so I think that often, sometimes people just change with whatever the times are, right? So a perfect example is in the middle 1960s, there were only two black women on television. Diane Carroll and Nichelle Nichols. Now, Shonda Rhimes dominates Thursday night on NBC. And so part of it is demand, right? So when there is demand, I think you go in different directions. I mean, like Telemundo, right? So that's come about in my lifetime. I remember when Telemundo like came about, which is the Spanish speaking. And so I think that's a huge part of it, that sometimes people don't even have certain ideological beliefs, but they have the notion of what will sell. Where would PBS fall? You know, that's a good, I think that's a separate thing. Yeah, I really do. I mean, I don't know if we can compare PBS to Time Warner. You know, I mean, that's different.
Hi, I have just a couple of things. Mm-hmm. One, another debunking site is Snopes.com.
Sure.
Dan Rather is active on Facebook and has a number of people following, so if you like his take on things, you can find him. That with the Never Again, with the kids in Florida, mm-hmm. there have already been attempts to paint them as shills mm-hmm. and on the right side of the spectrum, that they are being attacked as a being a put-up job. So I just...
Sure, and why be angry if someone shot up your school, right? Like, now we're going to act like, you know, there's no merit in that.
All right, there's a question way over here, I think.
The question about PBS, that was interesting, and we were just talking before this session about government-owned, you know, BBC kinds of. So how is it, it seemed counterintuitive that a government-owned agency would be the fairest source of news. But as I travel, I always feel that that's a reliable source, BBC.
What, the BBC?
Yeah.
I think that's partly because it's outside of the United States, and so it's other folks looking in, and so I think that's a very different framework.
Well, in response to that, I watched a lot of RT, Russian television.
Okay.
That's outside the world looking at us.
Sure.
And it's total bullshit.
I mean, you know, you said it, I didn't. But I'm up here grinning ear to ear. I think that I'm not sure if we can compare BBC to MSNBC. Right. I think there are differences again. It's like going back to the PBS thing, which is why it's really important, because what you're doing is nuance, right? Everybody didn't have nuance. And so people will tell me that, well, I read it on the internet, and I'm like, what does that mean? And where were you? And then they don't even know. That's not the best thing in the world. Like, you know, saying that you saw it on BBC, that has meaning to me.
So two comments that maybe I'd just like to hear your perspective on, two things that bother me. One is that with today's technology, everybody is a journalist.
Yep.
Without that same kind of grounding of understanding fact, commentary, mm-hmm. opinion. The second is the human nature to react. So the second something is out there, that reaction without any critical thinking. And as I roll forward with both of those two things, I'm concerned about how we develop critical thinking and good dialogue in this country.
Yeah, I think that is great commentary. So I went back to this slide because I have a book called How Journalists Work, and I didn't include information from that book in this presentation. But once again, I had to ask myself, why in the world are these books even needed? And so I agree with you, everyone thinking that they're a journalist. Actually, it's a training, right? It's a profession. Just because you can write something and upload it .com on the internet does not make you a journalist. And so, I think that's critical. I think you asked something else that I want to make sure I responded to or commented on something else. Mm-hmm. I think that's because the world's so, I'll repeat that because you didn't have the mic. She's talking about the tendency today to see something and react. I think part of that is because the world moves so much more quickly now that you can react. So you can, you know, be in a school where there was a shooting and you can have your device and you can record it or you can make commentary. In the moment, we couldn't always do that. And so that's one of the critiques of information overload is if all that's going on, it doesn't leave you room to pause and have critical thinking. And so that's it. So when the news goes off at either 10 or 11, hopefully you had like the whole night to like process and like not boot back up until the next morning. If it's just going on 24 hours, where's the stop and pause? And I actually don't have a position on if 24-hour news is a good thing or a bad thing, because I think that depending on the situation, it could be either. And I also think that other countries, like when we bring up the BBC, everywhere else in the world has 24-hour news. What would it mean if we didn't?
I got an interesting anecdote about where people get their news. I work with young people, high school people at a church, and we kind of got tired after a while of all these phones ringing and people texting while we're holding class. So this is a couple years ago. We came in and we had everybody hand in their phones, and they were enraged.
Oh, sure.
Some were mad.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and they said, "You don't have that right." They seemed to think it was in the Bill of Rights or something.
Right. Well, that's their version of the First Amendment, is that I can have my iPhone at the dinner table. Okay.
And I've worked with them for 10, 12 years, and I have yet to see somebody walking into class with a newspaper.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I love that comment because that really concretely speaks to how we understand things, right? And so I think people of a certain age have memories of their parents, for instance, you know, reading the newspaper. Like I have vivid memories of, you know, that's what they did, and they would like, you know, share sections and they would talk about it. And I can honestly say my kids don't see that. Partly because my husband and I are so technology, even though what we're reading on our technology is a newspaper. But I think the fact that people aren't using some paper items is concerning. I mean, I had an embarrassing thing happen. One of my kids told the teacher that we didn't have a dictionary in the house. And I was like, oh my gosh, right? And so the teacher has like no idea who we are, what we do for a living. So I have to go into parent-teacher conference, and the teacher is kind of, you know, like, dictionaries are very important. And I was like, thank you, ma'am. And we actually do have a paper dictionary. I'm not trying to be defensive, but we actually do. But it made me understand something about how we were being read as parents. And so this particular child was explaining to me, well, all I ever see you and dad is like on screens. And I was like, oh, okay. And so that it says something. Now, my kids will see me with paper books, right? But it says something that we're moving away from the paper. And I'm not sure it's a good thing, because studies always show that we do take in information differently when it's in paper. We really do.
Wow, it's loud. If you'd help me with, the Post, mm-hmm. okay, the lady that owned the Post, mm-hmm. Catherine
Graham
mm-hmm. and the editor of the Post,
Ben Bradley,
mm-hmm. and then the guy that stole the Pentagon Papers.
Daniel Ellsberg.
See?
Okay.
You guys got it. We're good.
This happened, you know, and mm-hmm. it was groundbreaking news,
right.
And they had to really try and see if they could do it ethically and not be thrown in jail, and it was mm-hmm. Supreme Court stuff and mm-hmm. all of that, and incredible things happening. But, like, Snowden has come out and stolen secrets or mm-hmm. whatever from the NSA, and they say that they're unbelievable, you know, things that have happened that are real things, but that's not been followed up by any of the media. Could you kind of compare and contrast and tell me why the difference?
You know, I'm not sure if I can compare and contrast, because I mean, those are really different moments, right? I mean, what are we talking here, like a 50-year spread, right? So those are really different moments. But I think that the media, depending on who they're owned by, right, can have a vested interest in what we know and what we don't know. And so the thing that comes to mind is when Occupy Wall Street happened, and there were people who were saying, well, why doesn't that get much coverage? And I was like, well, you know, what's the vested interest in something like, I don't know, the Wall Street Journal, right? writing like a positive story about like young people that want to occupy Wall Street. I mean, it seems to be a conflict. And so I think that's what happens, you know. Off the top of my head, I don't know if I can do, you know, 60s, 70s to the present, because there's so many different factors in terms of how the nation is going to look at the Pentagon Papers and Snowden. Like, it's super interesting, but I'm like, wow, there are a lot of competing things going on there.
This gentleman.
Yeah, Professor, this last election, some of the reporters, some good reporters in the Post and the Times have made apologies about what a lousy job they did covering this election. Mm-hmm. And they did it basically tied to this last gentleman's comment about profits. They wanted to write different stories, but their editors told them, and even news people or TV people said, no, cover Trump. He's good for ratings.
Right. I mean,
everything was about the money, and they were mm-hmm. not allowed to do what they needed to do, and they're embarrassed about what they did, and now they're pledging to do better.
I mean, I think that is excellent commentary, because see, it goes back to this Snowden thing. I don't know who wants that story out there or not, right? Like, I don't really feel comfortable, or not, right? And I don't feel comfortable saying, you know, this venue does or doesn't, but, you know, if we aren't seeing stories, I would just say there's a reason, right? There's a reason for that.
In response to the comment about collecting kids' phones in the school, now, most phones have a camera built into them. Mm-hmm. A police officer needs a warrant to take your camera. That's what I've been led to believe. Now, if a police officer needs a warrant to take them, how does a school teacher get away with taking?
Well, I mean, I have to speak on the authority of teachers.
I'm not saying I'm against collecting.
I have to speak on the authority of the classroom and say, you know, we should be allowed to contain that somewhat. I had a student one time that tweeted something that happened in my class, and she was criticizing her classmate. And now I have a policy on every syllabus that says there's no tweeting allowed. So I'm gonna give you the pushback that I got. So someone said, well, I'm allowed to tweet the sermon in church. And I said, you are not allowed to tweet the prayer meeting. And even if you are, this is my rodeo. And so it has worked, but you know, and I'm not the police, but I mean, I think that there needs to be some sense of being attentive, like young people who are distracted and they're supposed to be in learning space. And then with what I'm doing in the classroom, there needs to be a sense of safe space, right? So there needs to be a sense of, if you make a comment in class that someone doesn't think is, you know, that bright or informed, you're not being made fun of for thousands of people to see. Like, I feel like it's my job to make people feel that they can take a chance. You know, we're talking about 20-year-olds. Take a chance and say something that might need to, might need to think about that a little bit more, but that doesn't mean you need to be shamed.
Yeah. Another question? Who hasn't had yet answered? Yes, there we go, on the other side. Okay, sorry for the delay. All right.
Thank you. So I wonder what you're hearing from your, not your children, or maybe your children, but also your students, as to where they get news from. Because I know, I mean, it's concerning that media is so concentrated in mm-hmm. a few corporations. But our kids who are in their 20s and even 30s don't get their information from basically any of those news sources.
Right.
There are many more independent. And how do you balance kind of the democratization, so you get a lot more independent sources who want to tell a lot more varied stories, but may not have the same journalistic standards as mainstream media?
Yeah, I think it's a challenge. Like, I think some younger folks are on Instagram and they're sharing information through that, and like Snapchat and all these other things that I can't possibly keep up with. And once again, it goes to this notion of who is a journalist. Then people are, you know, reading stories that maybe their friends wrote. Right? I mean, that's the other thing. And so there's no discernment about what commentary is.
Question? Okay, all right.
Thank you. I still take the newspaper, and my favorite part is letters to the editor. So does that mean that Facebook is a giant letters to the editor? Because I'm not on it. I don't do it.
I love that. You know, the way that it can operate. So, for instance, I used to blog for the Star Tribune. So they would put my blog entry up, and then it's not letters to the editor. It's like responses to my blog. And so that would be on the Star Tribune site. Now, if I were to post my blog on Facebook, then people would weigh in. And so then you get all this dialogue and commentary about what the article is. So going back to your question about what are they reading, sometimes people get so caught up in the response, they don't even read the original article. I mean, seriously, because, I mean, what you have there is, you know, the comments can be so staggering that you start responding to the other comments. You might forget to even read the article. They're laughing. I'm like, this is my life.
I don't know. Can I ask, Donald Trump has a lot of information they puts out that we know is not true. Mm-hmm. Or at least I should say, there's a lot of media outlets that have done some fact-checking and said that it's not true. But he continues to do it. Mm-hmm. What can Americans do so that, I don't even know how to explain it, but the thing is it's disgusting to me what he does. And it's how do you teach Americans that you can't accept what the President of the United States says?
I mean, that is a compelling question, right? Because here I am just trying to have people ask themselves if something is factual or not. Now we're bringing in this whole other level is the White House factual? Which is like a whole different thing, right? But something that I think that could be happening, and I'd love to know what you all think about this, is that sometimes we just believe what we want to believe. Is that possible? And so I think that's partly what's going on. If you hear something that resonates with your experience, right? And politics is very personal, right? And people have their passions. If it affirms you, you want it to be true, right? And to me, that's not even necessarily partisan, right? If it works for you, then why go deeper and say and ask if it's true or not? And so I think that's what we're doing. I think that's partly how we got here.
You know, I'll ask a question and then I'll turn the mic
over. Thank you, Judy.
Okay, yeah. I have a son who about 5 years ago, when he first got out of college, worked for a year for one of the political parties. And his take on the Russian interference with the election is, you know, this isn't that new. That when I was working for the fill-in-the-blank party of Wisconsin, his job apparently was to write letters to the editor of small newspapers in rural Wisconsin. And a little bit of fake news of his, you know, sort of a little counter, you know, in dirty tricks of a sort. Mm-hmm. So what about that? Is this whole concept, is what the Russians are doing maybe not something new, but just, you know, better executed?
Well, that's it. I mean, I think we're just at a different moment, where things can just play out differently, right? I mean, I think that there are a lot of things that are happening now that have happened before. It's just that now we're really operating on, you know, a much broader global level, right? And so if we take it all the way back to what is libel, right, I think that criticizing the governor of New York in the 19th century is a little different to, you know, than, you know, are we going to a war, right? Which is what happens again with, like, you know, Spain, right? But I mean, now our technology is different. So going to war back then is different than going to war now. Are we entering wars that we possibly shouldn't enter? You know, I don't know. So it's been happening for a long time, but, you know, the stakes are different now.
Oh, let's see. I think this gentleman has not asked a question before.
I'm just curious what you think about Rachel Maddow. She's on MSNBC.
Yeah.
And what you think about her validity and her research as a journalist.
Sure. I mean, I know that Rachel Maddow is highly trained. I think she has a doctorate from Oxford. And so I know that she is trained well. Like, I'll be honest with you, the minutes in my day are limited. So I actually don't watch a lot of news. So, I mean, that's all I can say about her.
I think one of the dangers now, because it's so widespread, and I do think there's a different. It's about letters to the editor, because we know it's individual people out there writing them, whether they're bots or whether they're real people or whatever. We're not looking at that the same way as we do a news article. But I also think the danger of all of this is the mistrust and distrust of government that it is fueling, mm-hmm. so that people mm-hmm. don't believe, if they're public officials, aren't the ones from whom the true statements come or the factual statements come. Mm-hmm. And then we have all this news out there that we don't trust because mm-hmm. we don't know who's putting it out. Then there's like no trust in anybody, yet the public officials are in charge of things. So,
But here's the thing. If you are 45 years old or younger, you never trusted the government, which
well, that's
is partly
true.
Why I opened up
that's
with Watergate,
true.
Right? So I actually do remember Watergate just because I was the youngest in my family and like everybody would talk about it at the dinner table. And what I do remember about it is that my parents were shocked that it was the president, right? That it was coming from the White House. Mm-hmm. My parents were shocked. My kids wouldn't be shocked by anything. Like, seriously, I mean, I can't think of anything that would shock them given what they've seen in their short lifetimes, just because, you know, what's the standard anywhere for anything? And so this lack of trust of government, I think that's just a shift. If you're over the 45, you can remember when people trust the government. Well, you know, I think that time has passed. I don't know if we'll ever get it back. And I'm not trying to be overly cynical about that. But given the fact that, you know, a 10-year-old can have access to just about anything in their pocket, then, you know, that's where we are.
Okay, I think this lady.
As a person of a certain age, I hear a lot of comments about frustration with technology. Many of my friends will say, you know, it's okay when it works. When it doesn't, I want to just throw it up against the sure. wall, or I'm frustrated, or who's going to help me with this? And I think that's a problem, because the younger generation, we have a generation gap here.
Yeah.
They do not get overwhelmed. They right. figure out how to fix it. They call their friends. They, you know, I mean, they're used to it. They since my granddaughter, who is goes to Central High, is very adept, and sometimes she'll help me figure something out. But I want people to remember that, because I hear a lot of disparaging remarks about the internet and Facebook and all this other stuff, and it's on all the, you know, planted news stories. The internet has an incredible and will be an incredible medium for democracy.
Mm-hmm.
We all have it
mm-hmm.
in our hand. We have it in our homes. It's on our desk. It's individualized. Let's not forget the role it played in the Arab Spring. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, so we need to cultivate that. And I think we need to work with younger people in particular, mm-hmm. to just display more discernment in
yeah.
how they process the information. And some of your questions are excellent. Like, what do you see as my granddaughter watches a lot of podcasts. Mm-hmm. I must admit, I don't.
Mm-hmm.
But she made me watch some on North Korea. They're fabulous.
Mm-hmm.
And the disinformation that we get, you know, sometimes in 5 minutes is just totally, you know, thrown over by a podcast, mm-hmm. which comes, you know, by virtue of your cell phone, you mm-hmm. know. So,
I mean, I really appreciate what you're saying, because the book here on advertising overload, advertising is different than information overload. I agree with you. Younger people are not overwhelmed by all of this. In fact, one of the reasons why Dorothy Toth helps me with these presentations is because generationally, this is not how I used to teach, right? Now I know they need a laser light show. Right? I mean, you all have an attention span. If I just stood up here and talked, you'd probably pay attention. Okay? Someone born in 1997, if I don't have some YouTube clips and some pretty pictures and, you know, like, you know, some kind of, you know, prettiness here and this, they're completely clicked out. And if I don't ask them not to use their phones, then they start surfing. Because they're like, that lady's just up there talking. I don't want to listen to that. And so, right? And so this whole, like, you know, visual element to this, I know the faculty who are 10 years older than I am, they still don't do this. And what concerns me about that is with them, you know, sticking to their convictions that, you know, we should do textual analysis and stick to the text, which I think is important, they lose them. And so I will stick to the text, but I also know, okay, here's a pretty picture. Okay, now let's talk about the book. But they need this.
As a citizen, I'm kind of concerned about information that I don't get. And I wonder if you've, you know, have any thoughts on the classification system of government secrets.
Oh, I don't think I can answer that. Like, the question is, if I have information about the classification of government secrets, like, if I did, do you think I could tell you? I'd probably be in trouble.
Okay. Does anybody have a question over here that hasn't asked a question before? Okay, I don't think you haven't.
She was asking, you know, like, what do we not know? And I, in my response, it's like, I don't know what we don't know. I probably don't know either. I think that's a really challenging question in the sense that there's possibly Pentagon Papers and Watergate going on now that we'll learn about sometime in the future and say, oh my gosh, we had no idea. But that's way above my pay grade, like way, way, way above.
I don't think you're going to want to predict anything, but all of this leaves me kind of sad and depressed.
I'm sorry.
And I'm just wondering if you, given the variety and the different ideologies and all of it, do you have any sense that we can come to some common values again as a country, like we used to have maybe in the days of Cronkite and...
Sure.
So
you know,
forth.
What I have found is that, unfortunately, right, and, you know, don't kill the messenger, I think you need tremendous crisis to bring people together. And so after World War II, the nation really came together in a way that they had not before. But we needed to participate in this really, you know, large war. And so I think in the moment that we're having now, what has happened by some people's perspective is, you know, pretty big. I think a few more big things are going to have to come together before people decide, okay, what's a common notion of citizenship? So there is that, right? But then also I feel like I have to say that we haven't had a common notion of citizenship for most of the United States. Right? I mean, if we take this back to, you know, 1492, like Plymouth Rock, right? First of all, it's like people didn't have a common notion of what Great Britain was. That's how this nation got started, right? And then we come here. We've kind of been fighting it out since day one. I think this feels differently for people because this is a watershed moment for a lot of people.
Question.
Question is, given the gridlock in Washington, it's been going on for a long time. We know that they do one thing very well. They spend a lot of time raising money to get reelected. Do you think that they do anything else that's admirable? And is there anybody there?
Okay,
that
so I am being televised, and you're asking me if I think the government does anything admirable?
Well,
yes.
Should I rephrase that?
Yes.
Is there anybody?
And a special shout out to my dean. Like, what? What do you think I can do here today?
Well, I'll really put you on the spot now. I'll ask you this. Is there anybody there on either side of the aisle that you admire and you think is
now,
doing...
Oh, now, for sure. For
who's
sure.
doing anything well there? Because I don't know.
Sure.
I don't know.
Sure. I mean, Congressman John Lewis, my goodness. Right? I mean, there are plenty of folks that are doing things well. Maxine Waters is doing things well. I think Kamala Harris has a bright future. I think, you know, locally, I mean, you know, Klobuchar. We have people that are doing things well. And so what I think we have are people who have constricted situations, right? And so some things, as much as you want to do them well, that doesn't mean it's necessarily going to happen, right? But I mean, I definitely am not of the position of, you know, it's all going wrong. I don't think so at all. I think that Congresswoman Barbara Lee is doing things well.
And I just want to remind the audience, too, that this series, Duchess Harris Today, is brought to you by local government.
See, look
government.
At that. Look at that. Love you guys.
I think this is a press question. Why has the press not taken to task Donald Trump for his sexual harassment stuff like they have done for other people?
You know, I think it links back to the comments up here up front about who owns what. And I think I learned recently that Donald Trump is very good personal friends with the person who owns the National Enquirer, which, I mean, people might not consider that press, right? But, I mean, no disrespect, I'm just going to put that out there. And I'm not even sure if they consider themselves press. But I think that he has connections where people are concerned. It's like when the man over here said how the last election was covered, some of that being linked to what can sell. And I'm not sure that media, depending on who they are, right? And I think teasing out who they are, those big six corporations, I don't know what their vested interest is in taking on, you know, a sitting president of the United States. Just the way that I don't want to, you know, criticize government while I'm on television. Right, with all the connections he has, right. Okay, this much I'll say. I don't know about intimately connected to the press, but what I know, just from years of studying, and I don't think this is rocket science of any sort, money helps. Right? Money helps. And so money can do all kinds of things. And so I think whoever wants to have these positions, you're going to need a lot of that.
This lady has a question.
Sure.
Thank you for really outlining what the challenges and what the problems have been historically as well as contemporarily. I'm curious if you have any suggestions about tips for critical thinking or ways that people can consume the news in a critical manner or what they might think about or what they might do to help them be discern better the sources
sure.
of the information,
sure.
that type of thing.
Yeah, I mean, I love that question. I mean, actually, I think a lot of it has to do with just the first question, who has written this? Right? And because we have access to internet, this is why I agree with you that, like, you know, everything, we shouldn't throw out everything related to the internet. It's really easy to just look up who the journalist is. That's really informative. And starting there, where the site is, figuring that out. And then also after you've read it, asking, you know, what is the point of this? Is it an opinion, right? So the whole notion of, is this an op-ed piece, which is different than, is this supposed to be a factual news story? And for a crowd like this, you know, you all know the difference between, you know, the A1 section of the Times and the op-ed of the Times. And so, you know, Maureen Dowd isn't a reporter. She is a columnist with an opinion, which is different than writing a factual story. And so, you know, undergrads might not know the difference. And so I have to say to them, you know, Maureen Dowd is an opinionated columnist. She is not a news reporter. Knowing that makes a difference.
Next question, anyone? Oh, okay, way up at the front, all right. Okay, I think maybe you had
to. Certainly one of my concerns is in our current climate that is so intolerant of whistleblowers, and you know, with the Obama administration, I believe, prosecuting 8, and you know, the highest number in decades and decades, kind of thing. You know, is what we can do about that, and what that means with what we would call truth.
Sure.
You know, so I'm expressing a concern. I'd love to hear you say something with it, and I also want to make an announcement with Thomas Drake, who did serve time being prosecuted as a whistleblower, and sure. He will be speaking here in the Twin Cities this coming spring, and he's a brilliant analyst and comes out of intelligence and military, and anyway, his story is very compelling. Wow. Thomas Drake, you know, look for him in the Twin Cities, Minneapolis, spring.
That's a really, really interesting question. I think part of it has to do with if there are culture shifts in the nation, right? And so how tolerant will the nation be for whistleblowers? And so I think one of the things that's happened in the last 18 months is that many of us have been surprised about how tolerant the nation has been with lots of things, right? And so I think that we're at a moment where, you know, we just don't even know what people are willing to put up with or not, right? And I think we're at a changing moment. So I'm not sure the direction that this is going in, right? Because if someone had asked me, you know, 18 months ago, what direction is our nation going to? I'm not really sure I could have said, well, you know, we'd have someone in 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue who'd be tweeting, and they'd be like tweeting all kinds of stuff, you know, making accusations about fake news that might not be fake. And so where we're going with, you know, how we look at whistleblowers, I don't know if I can predict that.
This lady.
Just looking at, you said there are 6 basic news media and or news outlets, what'd we call them? And they're owned by people.
Yep, 6 you corporations know, that own media outlets.
Those corporations are all on the stock market or
yes,
whatever.
Exactly. Yep.
But they're owned by certain people. And just looking at our current congressional deadlock, one of the reasons it's been stated that maybe we're in that is since people can give money to campaigns without it being known. But I'm told that the Federal Communications Commission can publicize who puts ads out for people.
Okay.
So they could actually be known who does the political ads, or maybe knowing more of what our media, who owns it, would make a difference. What do you think about that?
Okay, I mean, for certain, I'm not an FCC expert, so I'm not gonna try to play one here on TV. But I'm just thinking that there's a new billboard on University Avenue in St. Paul about Michelle Bachmann, right? And it's up there and it says anonymous. And so I'm not sure if, you know, you have to say, you know, who puts an ad out, because that just went up like in the last 6 weeks. And it's still up there, by the way. And so, you know, I don't know. She's not running for office, so that might be a different thing. Like, I would honestly say, I mean, if we are talking about, I don't know, electoral politics and, you know, FCC regulation, like that's on a level that, you know, I can't respond to in terms of if you're giving to campaigns, you know, if your name has to go along with it. And I'm also thinking to myself that we are a creative country, that I think there's a way that you can probably do a lot of stuff and people not know that you did it. So, you know, even if those laws are on the books, you know, people spend a lot of time getting around laws.
Okay, I think we have just time for a couple more questions. I see one over here. Is there anybody who has not yet asked a question? Okay.
I just want to thank you for your efforts to do this series of books, because you're teaching these young people what this is all about and keeping it real. On the other side of that, we've dogged young people fairly heartily today. But I happen to have the great privilege of hanging around with a lot of young people, and there is some powerful positive energy out there.
Sure.
So don't be depressed.
Yeah,
start
hanging around
with some young people.
Don't be. And I mean, I am, you know, I'm speaking with, you know, compassion. Like, I mean, I picked my profession for a reason. Like, I love 18 to 22-year-olds. Like, some of it can drive me crazy, like any other kind of job. But I mean, I do think that it's our responsibility to share this information with them. And I think that they are willing to take it in. And I think there really are some things about the internet that provides a democracy. And I think some of the ways that they are learning really, you know, are head and shoulders beyond how we learned. I think it would have been helpful for me when I was in college to be able to just look up information. And so I think that there is a balance to this, and I really don't mean to disparage the young people. I'm just partly like jealous because I can't believe that, you know, here I am.
I think we have time for one more question. Is there anybody with a last question? Okay, here we go.
Certainly I have my own favorite independent, you know, high-quality journalism sources, and I'm wondering, what are yours, and what do you sort of put out there on the menu for your students?
Sure, that's great. I mentioned in my last lecture that I've blogged for the Huffington Post. I read Politico. I read, you know, obviously locally, Star Tribune, Pioneer Press. I mean, you know, I also just, once again, I am one of those people that I'll read the Washington Post article, and then I'll look to my friends who are academics for what their commentary is. And then I'm friends with Jelani Cobb, who is on the faculty of Columbia University in the School of Journalism. We had him in Macalester last year. He writes for The Nation. And so, you know, that kind of work. Ta-Nehisi Coates, who writes for The Atlantic, that kind of thing.
And I'll put in a word for ProPublica. It's a nonprofit, news-oriented organization. Anybody know about ProPublica? It's great.
Awesome.
And it's not—it's nonpartisan as well.
Well, I will say that if you have me back in 2019, I'll be here.
All right. Thank you very much. We hope to see you all next week for Nick Hayes.
Can you look them up on the internet?
Yep, you can go on barnesandnoble.com.